Plexi Black keeps fighting back. But oh dear, here comes the fight.
It's going to be the jump into Broken Shard. Then Half HP jumps into the air. Who's going to get the first real bit of damage down? Broken Shard does fall down. 1-0 C9T. Robert XD forced to flash away. One shot from Dead puts the cooling down. Flash attack from Altec gets the kill. Probably in a bad spot. Bump it up as well. Multiple kills coming through. Only one traded back. It's going to be a 4-1 and another triple kill for Altec for C9T.
Altec is a monster right now.
Hey everyone, welcome back to the 2014 North American Challenger Series Spring Playoffs. It's time for Game 2 between Complexity Black and Cloud9 Tempest. But first, I'd like to welcome Team Curse mid laner Voivoi to the desk. How's it going?
Pretty good.
Welcome back. We missed you.
I know. I was all gone right. For so long.
What were your initial thoughts on that game that got a little out of control?
Yeah, so obviously Cloud9 Tempest took an early lead with the bad level 1 for Complexity Black. They got the 2-kill advantage with... It did happen pre-level, or 4 minutes, so it wasn't like game-breaking, but obviously if you start off at such a big disadvantage, you're going to have a bad time for the game. And actually, Complexity Black did a decent job of coming back, relatively speaking, considering the bad level one. They got in the 4v1 kind of push scenario, kind of traded two turrets evenly, and then although Cloud9 did have an advantage, Complexity Black did start getting some picks off. Probably actually did die 1v1 mid, and then, but besides for that, he actually made a lot of plays with LeBlanc, and I think... Obviously, Complexity Black's team comp was revolved around getting picks. They don't really excel at much. They don't have a strong split pusher. Warwick can't really pressure Shyvana ever in the 1v1 scenario. They don't really have great team fight potential. Like I said, going into the game, the way they were going to win the game is off of just denying them vision and getting picks off. And although they were able to do a decent job of that, they picked up a few random kills here and there. They weren't able to translate it into a big enough lead to take any major objectives. I think they got like one dragon or something off that. But when you saw like Cloud9 Tempest get into like the siege scenario or even the team fights, they just had a really big decisive advantage. And when they started grouping up and just like throwing Ziggs bombs and Corki rockets at Complexity Black, they were just kind of sitting there. They didn't have a hard engage support. They didn't have really their engage was Warwick ulting one person and trying to give him. And when you're playing versus like a Kha'Zix or something, you can't even give him. And that was the target that they chose to go on a few times in the fight. So. Really, Complexity Black did not have too many opportunities to win the game, given their early disadvantage and they weren't able to translate like their pick comp into like solid enough leads to take the game back in their control.
So, what do you think kept them then? Because they found like those 6 kills in a row, kind of in early mid game.
Yep.
What kept them from just like constantly finding more of those and eventually just having 70 kills?
Yeah. So
that is.
They got a few kills and. When they were getting those kills, there was already a pretty big gold lead. Although they were picking up kills, you saw that the CS numbers were still going in favor of Cloud9. Ziggs had a pretty big CS lead over the LeBlanc, even though she was able to rack up like 2 or 3 kills. And that's just gold in their pocket. And when even if you're getting kills, if the gold is relatively even or Cloud9 has the lead with that team comp, they're just going to end up coming out ahead in the team fights. And Complexity Black was able to establish a decent level of vision control. They actually at one point had like 3 pink wards in the dragon pit, but even with that vision, if the fights just evolve into like 5v5 team fights, Cloud9 is going to come out ahead, and that's what we saw happen. The dragon really doesn't matter that much when you have a bad team comp, and even if you can pick up a dragon or two, if you're going to just lose out mid game in the push scenario or the 5v5 team fight, it's just going to have really bad implications for your whole game.
Yeah, and that game kind of being in the rearview mirror, Altec went completely nuts in that one. As you're moving towards game two, if you are putting yourselves in the shoes of Complexity Black, what are the main adjustments that you have to make to keep Altec in check and also to win the game?
Yeah, if I was Complexity Black, I probably wouldn't consider it like Altec like went crazy. He got really big on Corki, and obviously that became a problem, but I think that could have happened on any other AD if the game was playing out like that. I would honestly expect them to try a vastly different team comp. They tried the pick comp, they tried vision control, and just like looking at make plays off that, and it didn't really work out too well. And maybe they'll try it again. Maybe they consider like the 2-0 start for Cloud9 like the biggest factor, which honestly it probably is. Anytime you go into a competitive match and you start the game off losing first blood or just getting devastated in a level 1 fight, it's going to be pretty rough from there on out. And honestly, I'm not sure what they're going to try, but I think they will go with a different strategy.
Okay, so then game two, of course, C9T already up 1-0. What's your prediction for the second one?
I would say that Cloud9 Tempest is probably going to take the next game. I think they're going to ride off the momentum off the first big win, and I think that Complexity Black is still probably a little bit shaken off that first loss, but I don't know. Maybe they'll pull a big comeback.
All right, Vobe, thank you very much. We're going to get ourselves now into Champions League in just a second. So game two's going to be underway in just a minute here. So, Jat, then, talk to you about this one. I know Vobe said that CLB going to look maybe for a different strategy here in this
Absolutely.
One. Maybe not the heavy pick comp, of course. They also switched sides, which means first pick Kha'Zix, that's even available. That would go to Brokerchard instead. And we'll see if that makes differences as well.
Yeah, I think the team composition they picked last game is really out of character for them.
Mm.
You know, I think they should go right with what Vobe said. I think they should be the ones doing the team fight composition and forcing objectives that way. And also, you know, better level one.
Yeah.
If they're going to check an enemy brush, send five people, especially if they're bringing a teleport. I think that was a huge miscalculation. Yes, there is randomness in the game at level one, but that was a misplay.
Yeah.
More so than just bad luck.
They're too confident in the fact that no one was going to be in that brush, and CNIT was there. And you know, it's one thing to look for. So the bans
They're really targeting Broken Shard. Check this out.
Yep, Lee Sin, the Kha'Zix coming through again. That was first picked last time by C9T because they don't want that to go across. The Nidalee ban, the Evelynn. It's my third time now getting that one wrong this weekend. I keep getting those two champions.
Nidalee and Eve?
No, Eve and Evelynn. Although, there.
Eve and Evelynn?
See? I'm still doing it. Elise and Evelynn. I can't get those names apart. I think that they banned them both, so I can't get it wrong anymore.
Well, they both have, like, similar facial structure.
It's just the fact that they have, like, a hard E sound in them, because you usually say Eve, then Eve
They're
and Elise.
They're both junglers.
They're both junglers. That actually makes it worse.
They can be invisible occasionally.
Yeah. The main color of their face starts with B and L, black and blue.
Serac is a huge pick.
Straka is a huge pick that's going to come through for Prowl.
Honestly, that's massive. I am of the opinion Straka is nuts right now.
Yeah.
She is, like, one of the best competitive mid lane picks at this point. Prowl can just overpower people in the mid lane with it.
Mm-hmm.
And it gives them so much teamfight power. It's exactly what they didn't have last game where they're all picks. Straka teams are just this mob of Starcall and Magic Resist Shred that moves into your team.
Yes.
And now Complexity Black has it. It was banned last game.
Yeah, well, it's interesting as well because, so I guess they wanted that over the LeBlanc. From my talks with them, actually, they said like LeBlanc was like the number one mid laner, and then you'd have a bunch of other guys right underneath it in the next tier, but wanting Soraka as soon as it's up with, you know, only one other mid laner really banned here. Quirky Karma, though, still the pick for C9T. They really want to make sure they get that combo.
Yeah, locking it down real early. It's the Circle of Damage bot lane. About what it is. I wonder if Bishu is going to break out as Orianna against Soraka. Because of the things against Soraka, Orianna is one of the best.
Yes.
It is very difficult with the way you want to play Soraka in mid lane. You want to kind of walk towards people, over shove, and just press Star Call, then get out of there. But you can't necessarily walk past the Orianna ball. All Ori does is put the ball out, just moves it little small amounts back and forth, pops it up over and over again.
Yeah.
You get destroyed. And
Orianna
is one of Bishu's two main champions.
It's true. I think last time they did something very similar. They only banned one of his two main, the two main being Nidalee Orianna.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't go for it. He actually went for Ziggs last game, despite the sort of like ban bait sort of game going on.
Yeah.
So I do want to see what ends up being picked up here. Of course, 4 seconds to go until Complexity Black have to pick their champions. They're going to say, you know what? Caitlyn for Robert X Lee. Shyvana. Nope. They do go back to Thresh. Okay.
It's one of the two bot laners.
Sure.
Yeah. They're just locking down Shyvana right now, so that Yazuki doesn't get to play it again. So that means Yazuki has to play something else.
Mm-hmm. Neither team connecting a jungler yet, unless it's a Shyvana flex pick.
Highly doubt that.
Yeah, I think so
Could
too.
Be.
I mean, pretty much all the big set of top tier junglers have been removed. This leads me to think, are we going to see a Feral Flare jungler so far? We saw primarily Feral Flare junglers.
We got to see a lot of it in European LCS. Challenger.
European Challenger,
A lot
soon
of
to be LCS in some cases.
Renekton top lane, Pantheon most likely not, so we're not going to see that this game unless it comes back on the other side. That's a bunch of crowd control there. Cloud9 Temp is just locked down with Pantheon and Renekton to supplement the massive damage of Corki Karma.
Yeah, and it's really early mid-game focus as well. These guys spike pretty early on, bully the lane, early Pantheon ganks, force the issue at 6, and then you talk about that 2-item Corki power spike, I think is true as well. And here it is. Here's the Feral Flare jungler, Xin Zhao, picked up here for Broken Shard.
Xin Zhao. I like it.
Yeah.
So, he's been seeing a bit of a resurgence lately.
Mm-hmm.
Very strong early ganking. Has always been one of his strengths, but then his ability to transition it later into the game is something that has most recently been increased. A lot of people would go Wriggles on Xin Zhao even before it could transform into Feral Flare.
Yeah.
just for the added sustain. And now, even though he's not the one to transform it very quickly or stack it up to an absurd rate, it gives him that little bit of an edge later on in the game. More life on hit and a little bit more damage. And it just puts him over the edge where he can compete with the other big junglers late in the game, and he becomes an immense threat. I love that pick by Broken Shard.
Yeah, I want to see how he ends up playing it. Actually, by the way, Lulu did come through here for Bishu, so
got to be a lot of supports pick. And shields.
Yeah, I mean, you pick first pick Soraka, and Lulu's still on the field. You get to take your time with that one. So, yeah, multiple supports here. Damage kind of moderate to low for C9T. On the Complexity Black side, they've got... I guess it depends how hard Star Call is going to hit, but you're going to have some decent damage coming out of Xin Zhao, at least.
I got to say, these are very similar comps in goals. Mm. As far as their goals are concerned, Soraka and Lulu both want extended team fights. You know, utility heavy supports, you know, heavy damage AD carries, gank focused junglers, and top lane.
Yeah,
you
top
know,
lane.
It's the top lane.
The normal top lane.
Right? Everything down the board is very much highly versatile.
Yeah.
A little bit on the defensive side. I think we'll see very long team fights in this one. But really, this is more of a just match of wits than it is match of team comps because they picked very equally.
Yeah, one thing I actually do want to point out as a distinction, though, is that Yasuke on Renekton went Ignite. So he has
no
Ignite.
Teleport.
Yeah, no Teleport versus the TP Shyvana. Renekton already wins that matchup early on, has a Combat Summoner to fight him as well, plus a Pantheon jungle we know to be a very effective ganker as well. On top of that one, now, we haven't seen much Xin Zhao. We know he's a great early ganker as well. They actually, I think, gank fairly similarly pre-6. Jump on you, do some CC, do some damage.
The question here will actually be, will that Teleport be enough to make Westrise's Ignite on Shyvana beat him in lane?
It's true.
Right? And also, Westrise does love to become a split push threat. Sometimes you teleport and you can kind of have your cake and eat it too.
Yeah.
But if you have the Ignite, you're much more likely to be a strong 1v1 threat. So,
yeah.
Another thing to keep on track.
Yasuke's going to be really scary in that Renekton. It's going to be, you know, the lane bully matchup that C9T is looking for. Honestly, C9T got ahead in the first 4 minutes last game.
Let's see if they can do it again.
Can they beat the record? Two minutes, like 15 second first blood.
1 minute and 10 second first blood.
See if they can have the time in this one. Complexity Black wearing blue.
Mm.
You know, their team color is never correct.
There is no black side in League of Legends.
Unless your health bar is all empty, then it's mostly black.
Complexity gray.
Yeah, they're just dead all the time. That'd be unfortunate for these guys. Hopefully, for their sake, they turn that one back around a little bit. Looks like an early potential lane swap attempt here. Now it's just going to be C9T putting everyone top lane. We'll see when they move around. It looks like we did have an early ward come out from Glebe Glarbu of C9T. He went over to his own blue buff, protected that one with a ward, and then peaced out. Recalled back and rejoined the team. So once again, if Complexity Black try to invade the blue buff, they'll get spotted.
Yeah, but at least... Nope, not at least. Complexity Black isn't grouping up again. They're trying a much more defensive, let themselves get invaded, and then try and react. But they haven't placed down any early wards. Bubba Dub has one in his inventory. He started Health Crystal Ward Pot, which means he went utility in his masteries for the extra starting gold.
Mm-hmm.
But he still didn't place it for early scouting.
We'll see what happens to these guys.
A little bit of disorganization level one.
Yeah?
Yeah. I don't feel like these are highly prepared level one strategies.
Well,
whereas Cloud9 Tempest at least has plans going in, it seems.
Yeah, I'm curious to see what happens, actually.
Are they going to do a four-man invade now? Because Yasuki doesn't have teleport, so they couldn't do a five-man invade.
Yeah. Well, one thing to point out, actually, looks like the invade's not going to happen. I mean, you make the point about C9T being well-prepared. That's one of the things I noticed with Cloud9 Eclipse, actually, in yesterday's games, in their grand final, actually. Game 1 and 2 had very distinct plans, both in champ select. They had a Shyvana swap late in champ select to jungle. They had a really cool opening level in the game 2 as well. And it seems like that was a successful thing for them, was their pre-game planning. C9T sharing some of the same staff. Had the situation here. Looks like we're going to have a sort of standard set of top laners there. Renekton will make his way to the lane. Shyvana, CLB looking really hard for the lane swap. They look for the 2v1 running across the map to do so.
They're actually responding for the swap. They're doing... Yeah, this is the buddy system once again. I don't know if they're actually going to be able to hit level 2 on their AD carry and support, though. But as you can see, the Shyvana and Xin sharing all three of those camps.
Mm-hmm.
So that I think they should hit level 2 off of this. Yes, exactly. That's the plan. Now they get to go up both as level 2 and try to shove that turret in.
So they're going to start top lane right away. No teleport on Renekton. He's got Ignite. We talked about that a little while ago, but keep in mind he can't make his way around the map nearly as easily. But Yasuke did hit level 2 thanks to the late arrival
of CLB's duo lane. So there's a bit more power on him.
Even so, if you're going against four people,
yeah,
you better run. Soon.
Yeah. Better really slice. Soon. Better dice. Get the heck out of there.
So yeah, they're going to push a little faster. But Yuzuki's going to have a little bit more experience. That'll be the trade-off. How fast can the four push down that turret as well? There's damage reduction on the top turret, not on this bottom turret.
Yeah, so
this is Complexity Black's game, though. They are executing the strategy a little bit sooner than they did last game.
Let's see how good the 4-on-3 is. Yazuki getting a little bit forced away from experience range. I'm going to see if he's gaining any little bit right here. He's actually most of the way to level 3, actually. Yeah. They're not
just gained a little
really
bit
stopping
more.
Him.
He's very close to even level 3.
All right, well, it's going to be a small turret lead, and of course, still the 4-versus-3 push lead.
They want to stop right after this turret. They're already going back. They're not putting into the race.
Yeah, Cloud and Tempest, so they know they'd lose it. It's a 4-versus-3 overall, but Complexity Black not trying to stop yet.
I wonder if we're going to see a fight here. You know, having Yuzuki level 2, soon to be level 3. He got warded over the wall.
He's 3.
They're trying to stop this turret push. They might actually push Complexity Black off because they know that there's been a recall. They did not know that Kez wasn't there. Forces the flash on Prawly, maybe more.
Early flash by Prawly. Stun comes out from Kez. Not going to mean too much more, though. But it is minus one summoner spell. Complexity Black losing overall, I think, on experience just a bit because they actually did get to stuck him up with Kez. Now not in the best spot. Taking a bunch of damage. Will he get the knockup? Exhaust used the flash, but he's still going to get hit up a little bit more. Glebe not going to have... No, sorry, Bubba-Dub. I keep getting the supports wrong. Sorry. But have no more CC on him, though.
Broken Shard, as the level 2, does not have his dash yet. So he was just with the knockup. He has a Q and a W for the sustain. But they're buddy systeming all over the place right now.
In the mid lane under siege. Bishu not going to take any damage here, but four members in the mid lane. Putting that damage, putting that turret down to half, of course. This is an early game turret in the mid lane, meaning it does have that extra resistance to champion basic attacks.
Really trying to rotate hard and fast here. Caitlyn, one of the best turret seizures in the game. However, Prawly's out of mana, so they cannot stay here actually that long.
Get it down about half HP. Outer turrets do not regen. Stun comes out to Robert Xlee, but he's going to be safe in this one. Takes the lantern. Out he goes.
Bubba-Dub threw land a little far. Threw the lantern into harm's way.
Yeah.
Instead of the safety, but he was able to get it nonetheless.
You ever flashed for a lantern that's out of range?
No.
You, like, flash forward to go backwards? I've done that.
Yeah,
you feel kind of cool doing it, and you feel stupid at the same time.
So, I'm still bad. A lot of times I have trouble clicking the lantern.
I do too.
Yeah. It doesn't happen for the pros.
Nope. They usually do a pretty good job of that one.
Click the lantern.
One of the reasons that they're on the LCS, they can click things on their screen.
Yeah. Well, that is the test.
Yeah.
Can you click the lantern? Well, you do not belong in the LCS, sir.
There you go.
These teams trying to get into the promotion tournament, winning this game actually, even though it puts them into the finals of this tournament, will guarantee a spot. But there's a lot of Cloud9 Tempest people looking to stop Complexity Black.
AoE Haste comes in. There's a jump on in. Stun not quite in range. Good play. Backwards flashes in. Lands at Glebe. And Robert Xlee not in the best spot.
There's teleport as
Broken
well.
Shard. TP will come in. Probably on the wings as well. Bishu
this
on the wings.
It's a 5-on-5.
5-on-5. Yazuki goes down for first blood. The chase now. A little bit of damage goes in towards Altec. Just the 1-for-0. And the fight is defended very successfully.
Just a battle of rotations at this point. All five people being behind a turret 6 minutes and 20 seconds is a little bit crazy to say the least. But being able to get that first blood on a broken shard is huge.
And I got to give MVP to Bubba-Dub on that one. Good lantern got Robert a little bit safer, and then a really good play stopped Renekton from really doing much on that one.
Yeah.
The rest of the team following up pretty successfully.
And because the kill went on a broken shard, he finishes Wriggles already.
Yes,
it's
going to
speed
minutes.
Up his farm so much.
Only 12 CS, actually, as funny as that is. But
yeah. We'll have to keep track of his Feral Flare stacks throughout this game.
He's at 5, because he started in the 4-on-1 setup, so there's been, like, no jungling by him yet.
Fifth of the way there. That's what we mean kind of about Xin Zhao, is he doesn't necessarily power farm the jungle. He is mostly about his ganks. So eventually he will transform it. Mm-hmm. But it's not necessarily a priority for him. He still gets his pressure through ganking.
Yeah, true.
Look at that. He's running by all of his jungle camps anyway. He doesn't really care about it. He just has the wriggles for the attack speed.
But he walked by a pink ward on his way up. He didn't walk through the brush. He walked by another ward, too. Broken Shard very much revealed to be top lane. He could counter jungle, I suppose, in this side of the map. We're going to see if Black can get more out of this. Yeah. Oh, wow. In the bottom lane, the Westrice solos his opponent at level 5 versus level 4.
And he's the one with the teleport.
Yep.
Wow. They were the ones that did the buddy system. They weren't the ones that held Yuzuki back. I gotta say, this level 1 strategy, level 5 right now for Yuzuki, he just started getting damage on him. Yuzuki just overused his spells farming. And Westrice just powered him down.
Yep. Double Doran's plus boots, gonna be enough. No boots for Erected means you can run him down in the long lane. Yeah. That's a lane missing a turret.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Siobhan just runs at him till he falls over.
Yuzuki has lost his edge. If he cannot beat Westrice with Ignite on the Renekton.
Now he's done 25 minions.
15, 16 minions for Renekton?
Yeah. It's a rough start.
Also, on this patch, he doesn't get as much health from Dominus at level 6.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a while until he gets that back at level 16 on Renekton.
And this is level 5, but he's, of course, still down a level to Westrice's Shyvana. We'll see how much that matchup matures over time. Blue Buff going to go over to Dishu pretty successfully there. Pulled a single mid lane ban, otherwise he's going to be all right to play Lulu on this one. Early Chalice picked up, plus the Flask. I've seen now both times the mid laner on red team has picked up Flask early on.
Interesting.
I don't normally see that very much anymore.
Yeah. Could it just be Dishu likes it? Probably build a last
game. Yeah, probably got a last game after like giving away an early kill. It was like a catch-up mechanism.
Yeah. Once you fall behind, just got to start drinking.
Yeah. That's interesting advice.
Yeah, when you lose in life. No.
Just grab the crystalline.
Grab the crystalline flask.
There you go. All right, Westrice back in the mix with Yazuki. 7 versus 5 now. And you can see immediately, he's like, you know what? I'm not part of that fight. Back right off. You can get the CS for now. 45-31, top lane now under fire as well. Altec going to make the moves on this one. Down a BF sword to Robert X Lee, though. 83-51 in minions, though. I mean,
yeah, Altec has kept
one.
Up his farm once again.
Yeah.
One thing that's happened amongst all this, a lot of Robert X Lee has been roaming around quite a lot, and Westrice trying to get engaged on. Nice stuns. Got all the way.
Damage. Can he drag it over the wall? Yes, he can. Does not take Turo Dagger either. And in comes the Pantheon ult, though. Not good.
Keep running.
Gonna be a slow, gonna be a bit of a stun. There's the heal coming in just in time from Prowly. Wish, will it be available? The knockout coming in, Lantern's not gonna be enough. Prowly takes the Lantern to get himself to safety.
Mm. So nice
heal.
Job there by Kez.
Mm-hmm.
Ganking without the ultimate so he could keep the ultimate up for the retreat.
Yeah.
Really making sure Westrice could not get away. And then a solid rotation down by both mid laners matching each other. Lulawalt, a greater save than Prowly.
Exceptionally well played on
nice
this
done.
One.
Nice yeah. done.
So here we go, bottom lane.
The red side thing with Crystalline Flask, though, I really just think it probably has to do with matchups right now. Probably
yeah.
puts enough harass down on the Bishu that he needs extra sustain.
That's my guess.
And in the previous one, it was just Prawley's LeBlanc trying to deal with the little bits of Zig harass that he kept
yeah.
accidentally taking.
Let's see. Ask Void about it after the game. Hey, what's up with Flask in the mid lane, dog? He'll be able to tell us.
It's exactly the same as us. Like, you guys were right.
I would
usual.
Love that to be the answer, especially the as usual.
Yeah.
I forget who it was who was talking about it. We had him on the analysis with me and Kobe, and he was like, yeah, even the casters are getting it right now. And I forget what it was about, but we high-fived.
Even the casters?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I hate
this guy. We'll pull up the VOD, do the replay analysis, figure out who it was who's making fun of us. Pick him from the LCS. Not really. Sans comes in on a B-shoot, the push towards the turret. I mean, probably is shoving rather a lot.
Rather a lot, and that's the thing. Mid lane Soraka just shoves.
Yes.
All the time. When High plays mid lane Soraka, he buys so many wards. One of his strategies early on in the game is he'll shove the first two waves, then immediately go back to base and just buy wards. Put them on both sides so he can shove in relative safety. Against a Pantheon, it's not as safe because the wards won't necessarily help you. Let's see if this Dragon Take happens, though. There is an Altec in the top lane, so rather dangerous.
And of course, a teleport for Devana to match it.
They do not have vision.
Nice, C19 doing it in the Fog of War completely. Bit of a gray screen, but here comes the wards over the wall.
Try and steal.
There was one. The jump comes in. Spike comes through. Broken Shard gets it. The knockout comes through. Here comes Yazuki on the side as well. Everyone in this mix as well, except for Altec. Off on the side, down goes the jungler. Going to be a kill picked up on that one. Top lane turret did go down.
Alright, lanterning in now. Right, that was because Corki was top lane. A very dangerous Dragon Steal there by Cloud9 Tempest. The ward coming in the back and the teleport, all good things for Complexity Black. They're going to continue to shove this one down here because Altec is still gone, and there's still a mismatch in the mid lane.
And the knock in onto Yazuki. Broken Shard's going to kite back in this one. Another kill picked up. Turret goes down as well. Big advantage picked up for Complexity Black.
They are on point this game with their rotations. Sure, the turrets are even 2-2, but getting that dragon and getting the kills are getting them rolling in the direction they want to go.
Yeah, 2,000 gold now, putting Complexity Black in a very good spot. Just past 1, 2, 3, 4 in the game. So there's a time to look out for. Soon up is coming 13-37. Always make a mental note, see if there's an LCS big play at Leet in the game. Haven't had one yet, but I'm always hopeful.
At who?
At what? Oh, at 13-37. Yeah. I'm always hopeful there's an LCS big play at that point in time. I was power dive right then.
Do we have a new hashtag for North American Challenger Series big play?
Yep. Hashtag NACS big place. All caps.
Done.
Done. We got Robotics Lee in the duel. Bloodthirster done, actually, for Altec. Not for Robert, though. Couldn't quite afford it. Just grab Zerker Greaves.
Yeah, Altec taking a lot of the farm here as his team is getting out rotated on. So it is a somewhat conscious choice, even though they would rather he gets farm while they hold off and don't die.
Yeah.
But at this point, the majority of Cloud9 Tempest's hope rides on Altec's Corki.
Yeah.
And that's going to be pretty big. He came through last game, but that was because of random kills and stuff. But there's the ult on him, probably Pantheon.
Great stun, Soraka, not in a good spot. Ignite comes down as well. He's trying to heal up, not going to happen. Kez grabs the kill, a gigantic Pantheon. Walked away with Swagger. Yeah.
Well, that's kind of what we talked about with Prawly in the mid lane. Sure, you can have tons of wards in the river, but against a Pantheon, he's going to be vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
Expect repeated ganks from Kez's Pantheon if they want to continue to punish Prawly.
Yeah, so he's 1-1-1, having a pretty good time of this one. Gonna be just gonna check the gold income and the jungle items real quick. 85 for the conservation, 171 from Riggles. Broken Shard sitting at 15 stacks. Still got a ways to go.
Yeah. Well, honestly, not too bad. For Xin Cao. One really interesting thing about the Feral Flare is the life on hit that it gives you.
Yeah.
Doesn't factor in with armor and magic resistance. So as Xin Cao gets more attack speed, not only does he have flat life on hit from his W already,
yeah,
he gets it from the Feral Flare as well when he hits champion, which can make him a bit of a monster in these teamfights if he has sustain coming in from Prawly, shielding coming in around, a lot of armor and magic resistance, and then flat life on hit heal. He will just get tankier and tankier as the game progresses.
Mm-hmm. It's a nice little combo. Yeah. He's going towards Hex Drinker and some kind of giant spell item. We'll see what it ends up being on this one. But wants to get himself tanky and a bit more damage. In combination, 1,200 gold lead right now for Complexity Black. Of course, outer turrets mostly dead on both sides. The bottom lane turret of C9T still available. See if pushes ever come through on this one.
Wonder if Xin Cao, we've been doing different build paths we've been tracking with Xin Cao, whether he's maxing the Q. Or the E. It's a choice based on the individual. So E gives you better ganking and slightly lower clears, whereas Q gives you slightly better dueling and slightly faster clears.
Please split in the difference.
Absolute.
4 in E, 3 in Q.
Hell,
there
why
you go.
Not do both?
Why not?
Yeah, they're very equal skills as far as trading goes.
Yeah, I'll actually check what he was at like 6 minutes to see what he's maxing first.
I'll cover the play-by-play while you're gone. You can see Prawly, Bubba Dub. Clearing out pink wards in the mid lane. There's actually a flank coming in around the back from Shyvana. Going on to Gleep Glarbu. Freak's ready to take this away.
All right.
It happens. It didn't happen.
Nope. She gets slowed down. Gets the root down. Grabs a lantern. Fully safe. All right. Yep. Brogashar, 2 points in E early on.
Absolutely.
Started with E. Transition.
Yeah.
There you go. Detectives on the case.
Robert actually trying to clear out these creeps. It's down to a 1,000 gold lead. So the game's still very close. Late game scaling is actually probably a little bit on the side of Complexity Black, especially with the Lulu nerfs that have came in. We talked about Corki's inability to get armor and magic penetration in the late game. But for the majority of the mid game, he's still going to be quite a monster once he gets that Trinity Force completed. This game is very close. So many turrets dropped early. Not many turrets dropped lately. Still two on each side. And the shove in the mid lane continues. I wonder when Kez's next Pantheon gank is coming down.
Oh, it's going to be available now, actually. He does have Flash as well. Of course, still no Flash for Prawly. Broken Shard's Flash just came up. Bottom lane's actually going to be pretty safe for Complexity Black here. We're going to see what's going to happen. We're about 17 minutes in on this one. Right now, a bit of a lull. Dragon is up in about a minute. That might be the effort for these guys. Of course, both comps are decent at team fighting. So it's not like one would shy away from the other one.
Yeah. I'd say at this point, if Altec can land enough missiles, he's immensely powerful. Renekton, Yuzuki is very weak actually right now with just Tiamat. Working on a Banshee's Veil, but not able to bully out Westrise whatsoever. So that's a lot of map pressure lost by Cloud9 Tempest because of that fact.
Yeah, and the fact that he has no, like, very little bonus health and no bonus armor.
Yeah.
I feel like makes him very susceptible to the fact that Xin Cao and Caitlyn are actually decent sized right now.
Yeah, they're gonna do a bunch of damage to him. You know, ward control over the Dragon Pit here is critical. Complexity Black actually has the ultimate on Shyvana as well as the teleport. This gives them total control over this area, and it means Cloud9 Tempest would have to panic to get in. They're not willing to.
All right, Lantern comes across. Robotics League going to rejoin his team for this one. It's going to be the Dragon going down rather quickly. No one even trying to contest. Slain the Dragon. West Rice.
It's another large monster kill.
Yep.
Towards the flare of the barrel.
Don't miss those smites. That's actually even more incentive to not miss your smite there, even if there's not an enemy there.
Yep.
Feral flare stack, conservation, smite all the above.
Smite that thing.
It's up to 19.
Yeah. The transform will be pretty impactful, but obviously not huge for Shin Zhao. Bubba Dub with the hook on a Kez.
Good
and
hook.
The
good
lantern.
To play as well. Nice play. The flash, not going to mean much. Kez, actually, Broker Shard getting locked up a little bit. Box comes down, not going to do anything though. Altec now jumping over, trying to get himself away. Here comes Vishu as well. Good Glitter Lance coming across. The Wish comes in from Soraka. Now Prawly's caught overextending, but the teleport comes in. Is it going to be enough for Shyvana?
Broker Shard
re engaging, going in for Gleeve Larva. He's going to go down. Now Vishu and Altec, the flash away. The knockup comes in. Vishu keeping his team alive even still so far. Oh my gosh, actually probably lived. I missed that completely.
Altec is doing so much damage, but he can't finish anyone off. A 2-for-0 and a turret kill for Complexity Black here. Altec still on the chase, but he's running out of mana.
Yeah, he's going to have to stop on this one. And of course, top lane the entire time was pushed by Yazaki. He didn't get a turret for it yet, but he is going to be pressing tier 2 right now.
Oh, are they trying to get the catch? Look at
that. Oh, the flash knockup. Broken Shard finds one, has to disengage away from Altec, grabs the lantern. See? They're good players. They can click those things.
Yeah, real quickly, too. So that means 3 kills when all is said and done. A little bit of farm catch-up by Izuku, but that doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things. 5 kills now onto Broken Shard.
Wow.
You would want your kill distribution to be a little bit different, but that's going to be a really tanky Shin Zhao in these upcoming fights.
Yeah, he's already starting up on Randuin's Omen plus maybe Mercury Treads for his item build so far into this game. It's going to be pretty happy for him. Not going to be going away anytime soon, so once Feral Flare does combine, he's a big damage threat that you don't want to focus first.
You can really see also how hard it is for Cloud9 Tempest to finish targets off. They do have this large amounts of AoE damage, but not necessarily great execution. Mm-hmm. Double heal summoner spells, plus exhausts, plus the shields from Bubba Dub's Thresh, and all the heals from Soraka. That's why Prawly was able to stay alive, despite being completely dead to rights. They just healed him up, and he could retreat through the turret. It was ridiculously close, and it had to be absolutely frustrating for Cloud9 Tempest, just putting so much in for a kill and not taking down Prawly.
I actually thought Prawly was dead.
Yeah.
I don't know how I missed that, but I was just like, oh, apparently he's not a corpse this time around. And actually, to continue our conversation about the Corki power spike, this is one of those games where you actually want to do, like, the Zerg Greaves Infinity Edge Corki, because you won't burst them out with missiles. You'll run out of mana, you'll run out of rockets, and you need auto attacks. Mm-hmm. It actually slightly nerfs what Corki does for a team, because he'll run out of steam in a team fight.
Ooh, Bubba Dub gets caught.
Nice flay, puts a lantern down.
The Fear Lantern.
Yep, it's a Fear Lantern.
I'm going to pretend someone's there, and then you're going to run away.
Broker Shard showed up anyway, but, you know, other side.
Yeah.
Still a great move. I liked it.
Style points.
Style points, absolutely. He's going to be safe in this one. West Rice is safe as well in the top lane. Didn't get pushed away. And the siege continuing, honestly. Complexity Black still just pushing the minions in pretty relentlessly.
Yeah. This is kind of the bounce back we were expecting from Complexity Black after having such a poor level one in game one, giving up 2 kills and then giving up 5 kills by the 5-minute mark. And then still making it a close game.
Mm-hmm.
That just speaks to them playing well today.
Yeah.
And as long as they didn't go on tilt, those good plays with the absence of the early mistakes should theoretically lead to a Game 2 victory and force a Game 3. They're well on their way to that Game 3.
Yeah, they've brought it up now to over 4,000 with themselves. No dragon available because they've been controlling that one pretty much on cooldown. When it respawns, CLB is already there to take it out. And the kind of slow play for the pushes, again, this is by endgame. CLB can dive. They've got a Shyvana and a Xin Zhao who can both be tanky. Of course, Soraka can augment that early on if she needs to, but basically, yeah, you can see this team basically turning it on later on and just going for it. But right now, they're just playing a little bit more slow control. Shield from Bishu doesn't take too much damage for that.
He's got the last Whisper Bloodthirster build on Caitlyn, so he's really into the ace of the whole damage there. There's no healing on Cloud and Tempest, although there's a lot of shielding, so that harass will stick.
There goes the turret. The jump in by Broker Shard as well, but gets rooted up a bit. Doesn't find too much stun. Comes out as well. In comes the engage, though. Yazaki in the front lines. Forced to dash back up, but gets knocked up. Forced to flash away now. The team's staying alive for this one. Wish still available as well. Summoner heals are missing a couple.
Yeah, they didn't even have to burn their summoner heals on the side of Complexity Black for that fight. Walking straight into a much stronger Soraka team with the Rylai's at this point in the game. Ain't working out very well for them. Complexity Black's going to continue these rotations and continue to force down these turrets.
They continue the work they started early on in the game. The engage might come in,
this
though.
This will be a tough fight. Complexity might look to counter-turn this.
Good trap stops Kez on the man drop, though. Can't go anywhere.
Yeah. If Cloud9 Tempest would have engaged after that man drop, they would have lost. So they turned back. Complexity gets the turret, and the easy escape.
Looks like they're just going to leave these last little golems alive. He's going to walk back without his brother. Missed that a little bit, but it's okay. C9T going to try to lick their wounds and get back into this one, but the gold lead is growing. 6,000 now. That number keeps going up and up, but the mid lane may be under fire. There's no one really of CLB around. We'll see if CNT can get their gold back in this game a little bit. Prolly's here to defend, and that might just be enough to scare him away. So it's going to hit a minion. Prolly silences all things.
Very scary, but the Fear Lantern has a person this time.
It's going to be the knock up the flay back on the two as well. The good disengage. Beach trying to stay alive. Leave Glarbu in a bad spot. One hit from dead. He's going to get away. Now Kez stuck in the front lines. Got nowhere to go. Pantheon falls. The re-engage, Westray's looking for more. Can he find Glebe? An E would kill him, but the disengage, the Q slowing him down. The flash E gets the kill. Westray's getting it with four assists as well. Pullover's going to find Yatsky as well. Hook is going to miss, but the double dash over the wall is going to make it work. Yatsky's safe on that one.
Even so, they get two and fear back many others. They are now face tanking this turret, going in for the inhibitor. How much can they get? Can they take the inhibitor? Minions right behind them.
Yeah, not going to mean too much. Westray takes the first few turret shots. Brogashar takes the next one. That's going to be the kill on inhib turret number one. 24 minutes in. Inhibitor now soon to fall as well. Just as the respawns come back up, CLB, take a lantern back out.
Yeah, Xin Cao fits Broken Shard's playstyle so well.
Yeah.
If you consider his Lee Sin and his Kha'Zix from days past, he is all about forcing the early fights and getting things happening, making plays. That's exactly what he's done this game, being 5-0-3, participating in all but one of the kills. And this fight right there grabs the lantern, one of many, dashes right in with the flay, his synergy with Bubba Dub very strong, and then Prolly was in the fight, getting the shreds down. Gleam Glarbu was low, effectively getting taken out of the fight right there, and it is just a mass of power when you're ahead with that Soraka team. Cannot be initiated upon. Robert X Lee, what are you going to do? He's got the Soraka backing him up.
Yeah, down about half HP though. Good rocket comes in as well. The damage low on Robert X Lee, but there comes the front line. The dive in by Shyvana once again. Ulti on the Bishu. Shields himself, does stay alive. And this one, the front line still churning forwards. The health bars running too low on C9T. Kill pick there from the Xin Zhao. The shield coming in late, but enough to keep him alive anyway. Alt-tech very low. Cloud9 Tempest just can't break through the healing.
Yep. The Soraka, the shield, everything working right now for Complexity Black. This lead is only going to get bigger and bigger, especially when you have close fights like that. The initiation by Cloud9 Tempest was very well-meaning. And in most games, that would have been a great initiate that netted them many kills and maybe even a turnaround in the game. But they are just a sliver too far behind that did not work. Oh dear.
Speaking of just too far behind, very nearly the catch.
Just a sliver.
Just a bit. Looks like it's going to be the Talisman Ascension keeping the team safe in this one, though. You can watch that fight again.
Absolutely. I mean, they got the catch on Robert X. You can see Shyvana wasn't there. Thresh was in base. And Xin Cao was down bottom. But they initiated really 3v5 before the teleport in. Teleport comes in and makes it a 4v5. But this just shows how far ahead they are. It's really just Broken Shard and Westrice here. Probably ran out of mana. Robert X. Lee was out of health. Yet they still just push Cloud9 Tempest back. They even get a kill on Yuzuki, and no one falls themselves despite that big rocket hitting at the end.
The only reason Prolly could heal there was the Athenians giving him 15% max mana on a killer assist.
Hey,
I mean,
it worked.
Yeah, I mean, why not? The item did give him some extra mana at the end of the fight, but it also speaks to how important blue buff is for these guys, and with C9T never being ahead early on, they never got to rest that buff away.
True.
Prolly was safe to just have the mana coming in.
Feral Flare, of course, was also transformed for Broken Shard.
Mm-hmm.
If you add up the life on hit from his W and the life on hit from Feral Flare, it's a lot.
Yep.
I would say at this point.
16 life per hit from the Feral Flare, 6 stacks.
Mm-hmm. How much from W?
W is rank 1 still, but it's 26 every third, so it's about 8.
Pretty nice.
9 plus 16 is 25. You looked at me with a blank expression.
I was waiting for you to do it. I didn't want you to be like, I'm finishing a simple math problem for him. And I forgot the numbers you were saying.
You're the one who thought, what, like 18 plus 27?
Yeah. Something was, math is. Actually, something I'm pretty good at. Just sometimes not.
Sometimes not.
But a 9,000 gold lead here for Complexity Black. Looking heavily like they're going to make this a game 3. They played much better. Mostly, I feel like their team composition was just way better this time. They work very well when they can force people around objectives. And that's what they're trying to do with the Baron right now. They have heavy vision control, lots of pink wards. And hoping to get a catch.
Yeah. And you talked about their the big frontliners kind of being the show for this game.
See, here's that life skill for Broken Shard. He's fully tanking this Baron.
He's pretty safe. And it's, of course, not affected by the damage reduction. It's flat life on hit.
Still taking a bit of damage.
Yeah. going down. Robotics League is actually not dodging the knock-up geysers, but...
Well, I think it's because he can only hit from that spot if he wants to hit over the wall.
Yeah. But he just, like, goes sideways once in a while.
Robotics going to help him out a little bit with the tanking.
That guy's going to work out for these guys. But yeah, so the Complexity Black lineup, the fun is going to talk about, though, good smite, is it's all about those two frontliners. They have all the kills in the team. Everyone else is an assist machine.
Damn.
Setting up Xin Zhao and Shyvana for all the kills.
There's a tank line for you.
Yeah.
Strong tank line against Corki is also immensely important. Those missiles do not go through people.
Yep.
So they will get eaten up by the tanks. Although they do magic damage. Not much magic damage being built up by Westerice or Broken Shard. That should come next. We're thinking logically.
Yeah, like Hex Drinker Murktread's like, eh. I mean,
yeah.
If he gets good ultis, then Broken Shard has like 80 bonus armor MR. But.
I feel like Westerice would have been well served to go Banshees after Sunfire, but he's going Radwoods. I think they're far enough ahead that they can be fine with it.
We noticed a change in build. Altec did go Zerkgreaves' Last Whisper. He identified he needs a more DPS type build. And I mean, I agree with it. I think it's the right choice here. I
would also, because all the armor stacking from the front line.
Yeah, sure.
Westerice and Broken Shard.
But I would almost say Phantom Dancer at that point.
Yeah.
And Forsake Triforce, because you need the crit multiplier.
Too late. He's got a phaser machine.
Yeah, sure, sure.
Inefficient now.
Yeah. Doesn't even have the zeal.
If he was starting from scratch, I would agree with you.
Yeah. Okay, well, we're going to see a bit of an engage coming in.
Yeah, Broken Shard says hi.
Then says bye. Yep. This is high again. Inhibitor now under siege. Down to half HP. Altec puts some burst, some poke. It hurts a little bit, but not nearly enough. Complexity Black, of course, wearing the Baron buff.
They will now rotate down to that outer bottom lane turret. Clear that one. There's a big stack of minions in the bottom lane. I wonder if this will delay Complexity Black. They could send Westerite back to clear it and then teleport and not lose too much pressure. Or they're just going to say, screw it. They don't care if that bottom turret dies. They think they can win on this push. They get a hook on the outer turret.
On to Kez the Fox, the big Xin Zhao ulti as well, but no one's going down just yet. A big tank line on all sides. Finally, Pantheon falls. Turret goes down as well. Nakaba Niazki, he's got nowhere to go. More kills picked up. 2-0 plus the turret.
Yeah, absolutely. How many teams have we seen die defending that outer turret? The one to hold that is a center one, but it's too late now.
It's going to be a 5-3. The team forced to disengage. Inhibitor turret's going to go down. Inhibitor number two also going to fall for this one. Complexity Black making the comeback here in game two. Now, will they close the game out here? Will they win it out? Westerice is going to recall.
They got a couple kills.
Though.
They don't have the minions right on top of it.
Hook
pretty nice hook.
Bishu engage from Broken Shard. No, takes a bunch of damage, gets hexed up, takes the lantern back out, but Nexus turret number one is gone. Westerice has TP back into the fight as well with the completed Randwins. Now goes in for Nexus turret number two.
Dive
in. They find Altec. More kills coming across. This will be game two going back to Complexity Black, making that a 1-1 as the Nexus explodes.
Yeah, and a resounding victory right there for Complexity Black. 13-2 in 30 minutes, just overpowering them at every stage of the game.
Yeah.
The buddy system at the start to get the turret start going down, it gave Westerice a big level advantage in the top lane. He then soloed the Renekton with a teleport Shyvana. And obviously, the Xin Zhao getting going as well off of that, sharing experience, was huge.
The big frontline completely made it work there. And then, honestly, they didn't even take all that much time to close the game out. Pretty average game, like maybe a little bit under. And yeah, just every step of the way, Complexity Black saying, okay, you know, we'll take every dragon on cooldown, never let those go away, never let any jungle invades pan out, and then said, okay, we're going to push this, going to push this. The Baron sneak was good as well, and just took measured advantages, and then said, all right, let's get a catch, let's win the game.
Yeah, this sets up a pretty cool game three.
Yeah.
You know, these are very close teams. We weren't really sure who was coming down. Complexity Black, if you were to average the two games, looks like they have a bit of an edge. They made some uncharacteristic mistakes at the start of this last game, but then in game two, it was more them just making some really smart and crisp rotations at the start of the game that granted them those advantages, not necessarily Cloud9 Tempest making a bad play or making a mistake like Complexity Black did in one game. I don't really know why I'm making that distinction, like mistakes
versus
strategic edges.
Yeah.
Because you theoretically make less mistakes and fix your problems.
Sure.
Whereas the strategic plan and the overall gameplay is something you can't really fix game to game.
Yeah, like, and I think it makes sense, right? You come into it and say, you know, if you throw away two kills by going into a 4v5 invade, that's like a hard mistake. It's like, okay, good job by C19 defending, but like, that's kind of like the default. you throw them kills, that's a mistake. You come in with like a really good team comp, it's like, wow, nice job.
Yep.
You've gone above the standard bar right there. In fact, I want to actually bring up a replay then of kind of the catch that I think closed the game, and it's a great Bubba Dub hook.
Hook lantern.
Yeah.
He had a lot of fake lanterns over the wall.
Yeah.
Where there might have been a person. You never knew if he was going to be pulling in broken shards. Since if we can pull this one up on the screen, we'll be able to see it real quick.
Yeah.
Because there were nice plays overall, and this was a nice hook lantern. There's a person. And yeah, this setup so much. The great thing about this is he got him so close that after the flash, Broken Shark could still dash and finish off the kill. And then, if we continue rolling this clip, damn, we're going to see Prawly's near death.
Yeah.
But it happened later.
We only cut part of that one together.
Yeah, it was still a nice play.
It was still really awesome overall. Yeah. So guys, it's time to take a quick break, but don't move. We've got a do or die game 3 between Cloud9 Tempest and Complexity Black coming your way right after this. See you soon.
Black. They're going to continue to shove this one down here because Altec is still gone, and there's still a mismatch in the mid lane.
And the knock-in onto Yazgi. Brokenshot's going to kite back at this one. Another kill picked up. Turret goes down as well. Big advantage is picked up for Complexity Black.
They are on point this game.